Still works.
Okay, so we were talking about the Medici family. This, God, it's really dark out tonight, isn't it? Tell me if you guys need me to turn. I bet you do need me to turn on a little lamp. Yeah. Those of you writing on books, yes, lamp. I'll do it. Okay. Well, I'm going to walk and talk and see if I trip and fall while this is taking place. So we were talking about the Medici family, who were this major, well, first they were a major political power in 15th century Florence. Remember, starting with Cosimo de' Medici, the father of the family. They became, for three generations, the behind-the-scenes leaders of Florence, getting their own people elected to civic government, and through them being able to run a sort of puppet regime where they controlled everything that took place in Florence. And at the same time, they're major patrons of the arts, which is really what interests us here, is their art patronage. And so we saw Botticelli's work on the right, a private devotional work, in other words, for use in private rather than in the church, like Filippo Lippi's had been, made specifically for the Medici. We know this because the heavenly throne on which the Madonna sits. And think about that for a second, right? The heavenly throne on which the Madonna sits has the Medici coat of arms on it. Talk about hubris, right? Talk about egotism. So that helps us to know it was made for them. And the fact that that coat of arms changed in the 1460s tells us it was done quite early in Botticelli's career. On the left, we see Donatello's David, life-size bronze statue made for the Medici to be placed inside their palace as a symbol that they are ostensibly equating themselves with Florence, right? David was a symbol used by everybody. Medici are using it for their own purposes, right? It's a cast bronze, and we're looking at the very end of the feather tickling the soft inner thigh of David. But you also see places where the casting ended up not working quite so well, right? Now, this placement of the David in the Medici family chapel, Medici family palace, right in the courtyard as you came in, meant that they're proclaiming to invited visitors this connection between them and the city. Because remember, it's a sort of behind-the-scenes manipulation of democracy for their own purposes, okay? Other people who were friends with the Medici also commissioned works of art to underscore their connection to the Medici family. So, for example, we haven't seen this yet, right? I just want to make sure. I have two classes, and I wouldn't have had this undergrad prof who, in the middle of the semester, just started giving the same lecture again. And since I've already given this lecture once before, I keep thinking, how many times? Okay, we haven't seen this. This is good. The Martelli family were allies of the Medici, friends of the Medici, right? F-O-M, friends of the Medici. And they commissioned from the Rossellino brothers, probably Bernardo, an image that you can see is really similar to Donatello's. Look at the pose. Look at the head of Goliath, the placement of the foot right on the bloody stump, which we were talking about with David, with Donatello's as well. And that sort of heightened contrapposed to pose that becomes kind of like a dandy, right? Like he's posing, like he's in portfolio in motion and showing off his clothes at the end of the runway, you know? And apart from the fact that he's clothed rather than nude, right? And certainly without the armor, you can see the similarity between the two and the overall layout of the figure. And this was certainly done by the Rossellinos for the Martelli family in order for the Martelli family to broadcast their fidelity, their allegiance, their ties to the Medici family. Right? Art being used as a sort of propaganda for this. I don't know what's going on there. There we go. We have a couple of other works with David on them at the National Gallery that we can bring into the same discussion. The painting on your right by Castagno, which I believe was on one of the worksheets, shows David at a slightly different time in the story. Donatello shows us David after cutting off the head with the sword. The Rosalino showed him with the sling, still with the head at his feet. And here again, the sling and the head being emphasized here as David sort of hearkens off to the distance, calls his armies to follow him after having defeated Goliath and cut off his head. You'll notice there's a rock lodged right in the middle of his forehead there. It's kind of disgusting, right? But there he is, and he's got a sling there. He's ready to lead them. You'll notice that this particular word has a very odd frame, right? The shape of it is a trapezoid. And that's because this painting was originally on the outside of a shield, a military shield that you would carry. And on the back of it, which you can't see unless you go set off the alarms and take it off the wall, right, is straps where you put your arm through to carry it like a military shield. So the painting itself is actually a leather that has been stretched onto the surface of this wooden shield. Now, as you might imagine, a shield like that is something that you wouldn't use in battle, because what's the point of a shield? Is, you know, somebody clanks their sword on it, right? And one, it's leather and wood, so what good is that? But two, why pay Castagna to paint this sucker if indeed it's going to just go get cut up in battle? Instead, what this shield was used for was for parades. Parades through the streets of Florence. Civic parades, right? We have the thing, Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, but that's not kind of the same thing, right? I'm trying to think of the Pasadena Tournament of Roses Parade. Something kind of similar around New Year's Day, right? A parade of civic pride. Now, a lot of people had painted shields that they would carry in these, but the norm, because Florence's government, right, was democracy, but it relied on sort of elite families only. So the norm on these shields was to have your family coat of arms there, because that was how you showed off I'm prominent, right? And I can be elected to government because I belong to this, you know, top 10%, right? This is the only shield we have from Florence, from the 15th century, that's painted with something other than a coat of arms. It's a one-of-a-kind object. Right? There's nothing else in the world like it that survives. And that suggests to us one of two distinct possibilities. One is that whoever carried it, David did for them what a coat of arms would do for somebody else. In this case, maybe it's the Medici family. Right? They've got David in the palace. Or maybe it's a friend of the Medici. So we have to think about the image of David on this as being something that proclaims something about the person who carried it. Now, another distinct possibility that it wasn't carried by an individual at all, but it was made for the city. Right? And whoever is the magistrate that particular year would get the honor of carrying the David around. Right? The bottom line is it relates back to this ritual in Florence, wherein there were civic parades, right, where people would trot out in their best clothes to show their rank and their status within the city. There was another one held every year on the Feast of the Epiphany, January 6th, the feast where the Magi first came to see Jesus. And the Medici sponsored that one and marched at the front of the parade dressed up as the Magi, which is kind of weird and cool at the same time. But Renaissance Europe was full of spectacle ceremony, where people would have these sorts of celebrations, often in costume. Now, again, our work of art shows this thing that we've been tracing in the 15th century, which is a revival of ancient Greek and Roman body types within Christian subject matter. Judeo-Christian subject. Right? So remember, Donatello was looking back at various Greek sculptures, particularly by Praxiteles, to come up with the pose and the kind of treatment of skin for David, his David? Because Daniel is looking back at a Roman statue called the Pedagogue. You don't have to worry about that. But the pose is directly based on an old Roman statue as well. So this is, again, that second phase of the Renaissance. The first phase, simply realism, Giotto Duccio. The second phase, the incorporation of Roman types into Christian subject matter. And Castagna falls into that. Now we're going to continue talking about the Medici and use them as a way of weeding through the 15th century because there's so much to look at in this century. Here is the grandson, the grandson of Cosimo. And I don't know why I got slides a lot of whack here. There we go. Sorry about this. Something's gone wacky. Andrea del Verrocchio, we'll move ahead in a second. A terracotta, that means clay, right? Cooked earth, terracotta, right? Terra earth, cotta cooked, right? A bust of Giuliano de' Medici, who is the grandson of Cosimo, the heir, if you will, to the power of the Medici family. And he, too, is depicted in military armor, but as you can tell from looking, that armor is quite ornate. Amazing sculptures on the armor, which suggest to us it is not something he would wear into actual battle. It's ceremonial. It's for parades or some other form of celebration where you're walking around in something that looks like what you would wear into battle, but is a much more ornate version of that. And that's exactly what he's wearing here. Giuliano was roughly born in 1450, so that puts him at around 25 years old when we think this was done. We don't have a date on the work, but he turned 25, and when he did, the Medici family hosted a series of celebrations for his coming of age, right? The fact that he is now a man, right, at 25, that was the normal time to do that. And one of the things that they did was to host a series of jousts, right, out in public, where on the old medieval idea, you come and you fight for the honor of the queen, right? But these were now mounted to celebrate the coming of age of Giuliano de' Medici. We think that because of the armor being so ornate and special, that this reflects the armor he would have worn during those celebrations. But since it's not dated, we give it the circa date, right? The C means a roundabout. We know that Moses is not after 1478 because he dies in 1478. He dies very, very young, 28 years old, right? And we'll talk more about that next. So here he is by Verrocchio. Verrocchio is a great name. Verrocchio means true vision. Vera, true, I think aloe vera, right? True aloe. And occhio, your eyes, right? True. So my college roommates used to call him Dead-Eye Dick because he was like a sharpshooter, if you will, right? The true vision, sharp vision, right? So again, I'm sorry these slides are kind of wonky. Cosimo de' Medici on your right, the grandfather of Giuliano, and there's Giuliano again without the label up top, but there we are. So now we can see up close that wonderful screaming gorgon or whatever it is on his chest as part of the ceremonial armor. Certainly revival of sort of grotesques that one would see in ancient Roman architecture. In that revival of Rome, right? But now decorating the armor in a way that tells us right away that this is not armor he would have ever worn in the battle, right? This is armor worn for celebration. And these jousts that were staged, I had mentioned they were based on the old medieval example of jousting in honor of the queen. But we don't have a queen anymore because this is a democracy. So, and even though they celebrate Giuliano, they are in honor of a woman's honor, if you will. And the woman was Simonetta Vespucci, who was best friends with Giuliano. It's a platonic relationship. right? She's married. But their best friend, this is hard for modern audiences to get their minds around, right? That you could have, when Harry met Sally, right? Billy Crystal says it's impossible for guys to be friends with women. It just doesn't work out that way. And in the end of the movie, they get together, right? That reference is totally lost. Because Billy Crystal's like older than I am. Okay. Juliet and Medici had this relationship with Simon and Vespucci that had nothing to do with sex. But it was deep and heartfelt. They spent time together, and that was okay because it was part of the custom. And it was what we still call it a platonic relationship. This is where it came from. Neoplatonism. Exchange letters, spend time reading together, right? But it has nothing whatsoever to do with romance in the sexual variety. So when it comes time for Giuliano de' Medici to celebrate his coming of age, he has these jousts staged in honor of Simonetta Vespucci. Right? She is his beloved. But I don't mean that in the way we tend to use it these days.
So right? Is that emotional affair?
Yes, depending on how you define emotions, right? There's no jealousy on the part of her husband, no jealousy on the part of Giuliano, and from all accounts, and this is not the only time we see this, right? If it were, then we go like, come on. But it's a fairly common thing, right? That we see this, and so there are emotions involved, but are they the kind of emotions that we tend to attribute to situations like this? And that's it. But the answer is much more fun for us, right? Do you recognize the last name Vespucci from your other history class? What is America named after? Who is America named after? Italian explorer. Amerigo Vespucci. That's her cousin. Right? Here before Columbus by 20 years or so. Right? A world explorer. So she comes from a very prominent family. It's worthwhile remembering as we study Renaissance art that a lot of the things that we're studying overlap with what we might study in other classes. Now, the relationship between Giuliano de' Medici and Simonetta Vespucci is rather interesting one. It's somewhat complicated in other ways, because shortly after his coming of age ceremony in 1475, she died. She died in 1476. And then 2 years later, he died. And we know it's not, from a broken heart or anything like that, right? Because he was murdered, which we'll talk about. It's a phenomenal story. But the fact that Simonetta had died and the fact that Giuliano dies, both within 3 years of the coming of age celebrations, are both reflected in this painting by Botticelli, this portrait of Giuliano. We think it's a posthumous portrait. The reason we think that is there's about four or five versions of this out there that might have been made from various parts of the Medici family or their friends. Ours is by far the best. But if we look at the picture, you'll also notice that he's posed inside of a window frame. Notice the interest in perspective again, right? Rendering that three messages. And one of the shutters on the window is open to nothing, to the great beyond. And we think that this is Giuliano's soul departing this world to the next. So that gives us the date on it being around the time of his death, 1478. Now, how does Simonetta enter into this? In the lower corner, there's a dove resting on a branch.
Got a detail of it, too.
Right? Nice close-up of the dove. Resting on a dead branch. According to medieval legend, Renaissance legend, right, doves mated for life. They were faithful to their beloved for their entire life. So including a dove is certainly meant as a reference to Giuliano and Simonetti. But over above that, Renaissance legend, Renaissance lore, tells us that on the death of the dove's beloved, the only place the dove will actually land, this is all made up, but the lore, right? The only place the dove will land is on a dead branch. So here we have a dove on a dead branch, suggesting that that dove's beloved is dead. Simonetta. At the same time, the open window suggests that Giuliano is also dead. So we have this portrait that has a really strong connection to the period in which it was made. A very important portrait. And the story of the death of Giuliano de' Medici is a phenomenal story. The sort of thing you could never make up. The Medici had enemies. You can't be pulling the strings behind the scenes for as long as they did and get away with it. Just doesn't happen, right? And the Medici ran afoul of other families in Florence on a regular basis. Right? So already in 1435, Cosimo, 34, Cosimo got kicked out of town, right? Had to go do penance before he could come back. Later in 1492, Giuliano's brother, Lorenzo, will get kicked out of town. Kind of the same reason, they got fed up with the Medici. In 1478, the enemies of the Medici got together and they decided that they had had enough. Three generations of Medici control have been more than enough for us. Let's get them out of office. And they realized that the only way they could do this would be to kill the next generation of Medici. The problem is, Giuliano's got a brother, Lorenzo. Which means if they kill Giuliano, Lorenzo will come to power and vice versa. They gotta get rid of both of them. And they gotta do it at exactly the same time because if you only get one of them, the other one will hide and come back. Right? So there's this plot being hatched to get rid of Giuliano and Lorenzo at the same time. They're gonna whack them. It sounds like something out of a mobster movie. Right? They're going to get rid of the next generation of Medici. The problem for them is, how are you going to do this? How are you going to get both in the same place at the same time, or at separate parts at exactly the same time, you know, when you don't have videos and watches and all of that stuff, right? How are you going to do this? The name of the group, by the way, is the Pazzi, P-A-Z-Z-I, Pazzi Family Conspiracy. They decide that they have this great idea. This is where you could make this. We know where we can get them with the pants, so to speak, right? Easter Sunday morning, during Mass. They won't expect a thing. If we wait until Easter, at the moment they're taking communion, we can get it. So they bribe people within the church, they hide back where the priest prepares the sacrament. So you think of a church, right? The priest is up here performing Mass, and you guys are the... And the Medici are right up front. You're Giuliano, right? You need a brother sitting next to you, right? And the place where the priest performs prepares the sacrament. Remember we saw this behind Jan van Eyck's Annunciation, the Ghent altarpiece, and also the Robert Campan. We saw the place where the priest washes his hands during the preparation of the sacristy. That's off to the side over here in the church, right? So you're in church, Mr. Medici, I'll pick on you because you're up front and you're a male. And I'm the priest and I'm performing this, so you're watching me, right? And you're especially watching the point when, as I get out there and I got the bread and the wine, and I say, "Behold the body of Christ, which is broken for you," after having blessed it. And the literature says, "Behold the body of Christ." So you're looking here, right? And at the moment the priest does that, blesses the sacrament, where by Catholic belief that wafer, that piece of bread, is now the real body of Christ. That glass of wine is the real blood of Christ. Hold the blood of Christ. When they bless it, they ring a bell. Right? To call attention, and that's the signal. Right? They realize that the point point when the bell rings, the Medici are going to be distracted. So priest, bing, 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 out they storm. And they come to get Lorenzo and Giuliano. Easter Sunday morning. The night before, right, end of Lent, Lorenzo and Giuliano are out partying. Giuliano twists his ankle. Hobbling into church the next morning. What do you know? I don't even ask, right? I don't know what I was doing. And as the Pazzi family comes out, knives ablaze, Lorenzo's able to get out because he's healthy. Giuliano's stabbed to death on the floor of the cathedral on Sunday morning. Easter Sunday morning, right? And again, could you make this sort of stuff up, right? It's a phenomenal story, right? So our picture here is probably just after he was killed. And perhaps made for the allies of the Medici to show their allegiance. Because what happened, Lorenzo got away. He goes ape, right? He has all of the women and children locked up. He has all of the men killed from the entire family. It's if you've ever seen The Godfather, and if you haven't, you should. Like, it's on Netflix, right? Right now, free on Netflix this month. Watch The Godfather. The very end, Michael's become the new Godfather. He's baptizing his nephew, right? And while he's doing it, he's having the entire five families wiped out, so that he's in entire control of New York City. Same thing happens with Lorenzo, right? Lorenzo goes ballistic and wipes out the entire family of the conspirators. And at that point, the people that are left are showing their, are asked to show their fidelity to the Medici. And they do this through art like they always have, right? So our portrait of Giuliano is one of about four that survived today. There are probably more before that were put up by people to say that we are friends of the Medici. We remember the fallen son, in this case, the fallen brother. Lorenzo has a series of wax sculptures of him made to be put in people's houses to show their fidelity, right? So you put up pictures of the Medici to say, I'm on the Medici side. Our statue, and by the way, we know that those were all made by Verrocchio. Dead idea, right? Our statue is made out of clay, painted terracotta. What we think, and this is phenomenal that we have this work, we think that this was the one that he used to make the wax sculpture copies to go in the other houses, all of which are now. Right. We're very fortunate here in the National Gallery, here in D.C., to have these things. When you think about the pedigree of these two works, how they got here, where they were, and how they were originally used, it's phenomenal that we've got them. Not only is it phenomenal that anybody has them, right? But for us, the National Gallery didn't open until the late 1930s. Right? We didn't start to plan to have a gallery in Washington in 1937. The Met had been around for 50 years by that point. The Philadelphia had been around for 50 years by that point. To say nothing of the royal collections in Europe. But we got that. Blows me away to this day, the things that we have. We have the only Leonardo da Vinci painting anywhere in the Americas. How did we get so lucky to have these things, right? So we're a latecomer. We're a Johnny-come-lately museum. But as such, we have things in there that other museums in this country would kill for. We're probably number, I would say, I was talking to our new hire in printmaking, Mary, about this. We're probably the number two art city in the country. I kind of say that without sort of thinking twice about it, right? The number two after New York, right? Now, there's some things that New York killed in this thing, so to speak, right? To have it as well. Okay, so that's. We're still going to talk about the Medici. They're not done yet, right? They're still around for another 20 years after this. Eventually, in the 16th century, one of the great-great-grandsons of this group gets elected pope. Right? Pope Clement VII is a Medici. So, the
spectacular sort of rise through power that these people had.
Polaiuolo, Abby. Polaiuolo. You can drop an extra vowel in there and there would be no problem on the midterm, right? Because really, look at that. A-I-U-O, right? His name means son of a chicken farmer. Pola, Polo, right? Pollos Hermanos from Breaking Bad, or just down here, there's a Pollo a la Brasa down on the highway, old the highway, right? Polaiuolo is Antonio from the family of chicken farmers. They were. And what's fascinating, when you think about what we've been talking about, these people in the Renaissance, the Medici were a bunch of doctors, right? And then became bankers, which is where they got their money. But a lot of our Renaissance people are people who made their own fate, right? That their hard work changed their status in society. Antonio is one of two brothers who become artists. And he works for the Medici family as well. Almost all of our artists at this time do work for the Medici at one point or another. And so far, the last six or seven artists we've looked at all have a Medici connection. Polaiuolo was primarily a sculptor, but he also painted as well. And in all of his works, he focuses on the human body in action. And we see that in both of these works. There's Hercules wrestling Antaeus. He breaks the rules to be Antaeus. Antaeus got his strength from the earth. So he lifts him up off the ground so he can defeat him. And you can see the vigorous action of the human figure. That was made for the Medici family. On the left, that was in their palace. On the right, we see 10 different figures in vigorous action. In an entire range of poses. We see this in all of his works. This was his forte. Right? This is what he did well. And the print seems to be proclaiming that, almost trying to sell it. This interest in, oh, back up. With both of these, we have ancient Roman themes with no attempt to make them Christian. Hercules is presented just as Hercules. Right? It's Roman anatomy, Roman body types, rendered in action, but now within a particularly Roman scene. So on the left we have Roman mythology, on the right we have what we think are gladiators in training. Right? Training for the Roman arena. Policy, fight to the death. So the two fellows in the middle with the chain, swords raised at each other, standard if you ever saw Spartacus, right? Hell, if you ever saw Star Trek, the one where Kirk and Spock go to the and fight to the death is based on that same theme, right? This represents a new phase of the Renaissance. We've talked about phases, right? First phase, 14th century, is all about realism. Second phase, 15th century, Roman body types, but in Christian context. By the end of the 15th century and into the 16th century, we begin to see an interest in Rome for its own sake. Roman subject matter. And we tend, as historians, they didn't make a distinction, but history writers have said that, yes, this is a new phase. Everything that happened before is coming together. We call it the High Renaissance. Roughly end of the 15th century, early part of the 16th century. It's fairly short. The culmination of everything that started with John. Let's see what's coming up next. Since he was so active in sculpture, one of the things that's fascinating is that it looks as we look at the 10 nude gladiators that are fighting, that you can start to pick out pairs that look like the same pose, but seen from different points of view. So the two guys in the center with the chain, each leaning on one leg, removing their weight from the other one as they lean back, are variations on exactly the same pose. And if we look further, we find this elsewhere, right? The two guys with the battle axes, variations on the same pose.
The guy with
the archer in the blower in the back right corner, and the man coming at him with the sword. Again, variations on the same pose. As if the print is there to tell us that Poliwolo understands the figure in three dimensions. Understands what it looks like on the back, and he's a sculptor, so of course he does get that. Right? It's showing off what he does best. Even the two figures with the figures on the ground, we can talk about that being very similar. Right?
So again, the High Renaissance, blah, 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 blah. This particular work of art
is what's called an engraving. Now, an engraving is a way to make a work of art and then made multiples of the same thing. An early form of printing. Right? So we call it printmaking. And what you do, this is from Diderot's Encyclopedia in the 18th century on the left, is you take a metal plate, usually a piece of copper, soft metal, and you take a hard steel point, you call it a burin, and you carve into the plate the line. So the plate is perfectly smooth, in this case hammered smooth, and you carve the lines that you want to print. You then rub the entire plate with ink after you've carved your design, and you polish it with a rag or with a hand. And what happens is that the ink, if you think about the spaces between my fingers as being the lines that I carved, right? As you rub it, you rub the ink off of the high parts, but it stays down in the little valleys that you carve. Right? You polish it off. And then you put a piece of paper on that, run it through a printing press with pretty high pressure. The paper goes down in those grooves and picks up the ink. Right? There you've got the print on paper. And you still have the matrix that you carved that you print another one tomorrow. Or more likely, in 2 minutes. Right? Wipe, polish, print. Wipe, polish, print. And every time the print goes through the press, it starts to flatten out a little bit because of the pressure. So it won't last forever, but you can get a significant number of impressions off of that matrix. Okay. That's exactly what Poliwolo has done here. It's metalsmith, right? And we have to ask ourselves, why would he do this? And this goes back to what is depicted in the print. The print shows what Poliwolo does best, the human figure in action. The print is also signed, on the left, the work of Antonio Poliwolo of Florence. It shows what he does best, and it tells us where to find it. What we think is that these were monumental advertisements that he could use to drum up work commissions for his work. Bring them to Florence. If you want someone who can do the human figure this well, come find Poliwolo. He lives in Florence. Now, we'll see some details of this very quickly at the beginning of class on Thursday. And move on. Our next artists are some of the heavy hitters. The next class will be, I've seen this before, for a lot of it, as we move into the High Renaissance, because this is the rest of our Ninja Turtles, right? This is Michelangelo and Raphael and Leonardo are coming up next. So we'll be moving through that, okay? So I'll see you guys on Thursday, and we'll press on ahead. Okay? One last thing, you got your bibliographies back, and if they weren't as good as you wanted them to be, and you want some advice on how to revise them, just make an appointment to see me, right? Some people have already done that. So if you had some trouble working your way through that, do come and talk to me, okay?